8:30. A new crisis facing Newsnight. Those were the words used to introduce the programme last night. Many will say they should have gone further. A new crisis facing the BBC. The corporation has been at the heart of the child abuse scandal ever since it was revealed that Newsnight had failed to broadcast a film making allegations about Jimmy Savile. The charge against the BBC, among others, was that it had betrayed the victims of child abuse. Last Friday night, it appeared to be trying to compensate for that, in part by broadcasting an item that did make allegations about children being abused. The problem was that they leaked some of that abuse to a man who had been a senior politician in the Thatcher years. They didn't name him, but there were enough clues in the report for him to be named on the internet, and many people knew the man was Lord McAlpine, except that it was not him. He was entirely innocent. And now he has said he will sue the BBC for a very serious libel. The man whose word Newsnight had accepted was Steve Misham, one of the victims of abuse. He said yesterday he had made a mistake.
Firstly, I'd just like to offer my sincere and humble apologies to Lord McAlpine. That certainly is not the man that abused me. That's certainly not the man I identified as abused me to North Wales Police in the 90s. And that's certainly not the man that was on that photograph. I spoke out within the first 5 minutes of seeing a picture of him. I was on the phone straight away and issued an apology straight away. I was actually mortified. I really did feel for the man and his family. This should never have happened.
Well, I'm joined in the studio by the Director General of the BBC, George Entwhistle, but let's talk first to the Conservative MP who chairs the House of Commons Culture Committee, John Whittingdale. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
What do you want to see happen now?
Well, the BBC has apologised, but that is just not enough yet. We need to know exactly how this came about. It is hard to imagine a more damaging, appalling allegation than to label somebody as a child abuser. And you would have thought that before any kind of suggestion of that kind was broadcast, it should have been through all of the proper checks, it should have been examined by lawyers, it should have been cleared at the most senior level. And yet it appears none of these things happened. This was a report compiled by journalists who weren't even working for the BBC, it appears. And yet the BBC accepted it. Was it looked at by their lawyers? And at the end of the day, the Director General of the BBC is the Editor-in-Chief. I would have expected a programme making as serious allegations as these to have gone to him for clearance. Did he know about it? Did he approve it? Did he check to see whether or not a sufficient investigation had taken place to back up these allegations?
What are you going to do about it on your committee? You're going to call Mr. Entwistle?
Well, we are due to be seeing the Director General and the Chairman of the Trust in a couple of weeks' time. In any case, they have an annual session with the committee where we talk about the performance of the BBC. But obviously, these are matters of huge public interest. I think it is widely recognised that this has done immense damage to the reputation of the BBC. That should be of huge concern to the Trust and to the Director General. And we will obviously want to go into these questions in some detail.
Do you have a view as to whether Mr. Entwistle should consider his position?
Well, what we need to do is find out how this came about. Newsnight was already in chaos. It had lost its editor, who'd stood aside. The director of news wasn't involved. She was implicated, potentially, about the Jimmy Savile story. So was it the acting editor who took this decision? Was it the acting head of news? At what stage do the clearances take place? Until we know the answer to these questions, then obviously you can't call for resignations, but this is a very serious matter, and the BBC needs to demonstrate how serious it is and that they are taking steps to make sure this can never, under any circumstances, happen again.
But you do seem to be saying that if you don't get the answers you seek, or at least you're not satisfied with the answers to those questions, then, yes, he should be considering his position. He should be thinking of resigning.
Well, I certainly think somebody needs to take responsibility for this. And unless there are very clear reasons why the decision was taken to broadcast, then they should certainly consider their position. But I mean, I'm not yet going to say who that should be, because at the moment we simply have no idea how this decision was reached to broadcast.
John Whittingdale, thank you very much for that. George Entwhistle, let's come to that question of your position a bit later in this interview. Let me ask you first, what went wrong?
Well, we made a film that relied upon a witness who yesterday came out and said he'd made a mistaken identification. That mistaken identification meant that the film we had broadcast was wrong, and we apologised for it because we should not have put out a film that was so fundamentally wrong. What happened here is completely unacceptable. In my view, the film should not have gone out. I've taken clear and decisive action to start to find out what happened and put things right. I've commissioned a report from one of my senior editorial leaders, director of BBC Scotland, which I've asked to have on my desk by Sunday. And further action will follow from that, disciplinary if necessary. But as John Whittingdale says, the key here is to understand exactly what happened before we leap to judgment.
And once again, we are shutting the stable door after the horse has bolted. Why didn't you ask those questions before the film went out?
Well, not every film and not every piece of journalism made inside the BBC is referred to the editor-in-chief.
Is this just another film, another piece of journalism?
No, it's an important piece of journalism. And obviously, I've asked Ken McQuarrie to get to the bottom of exactly what happened, and I want to be careful.
Ken McQuarrie is
the director of BBC Scotland. Yes, mm-hmm. But I want to be careful about prejudging what he says. But from the inquiries I've been able to make so far, this was a piece of journalism referred to senior figures within news, referred up to the level of the management board, and had appropriate attention from the lawyers. Now, the question is, in spite of all that, why did it go wrong? No stepping away from that. Something definitely and clearly, unambiguously went wrong here.
When did you know?
We now have to be clear. And we have to find out what exactly happened.
When did you know that this film was being broadcast? And when was it drawn to your attention that it was going to make extraordinarily serious allegations about a man whose identity would inevitably be uncovered? Now, wrongly, as we now know.
The film was not drawn to my attention before transmission.
At all. Nobody said to you at all
no, John,
in the BBC...
No, John, but I need to explain that there are an awful lot of pieces of journalism going on around the BBC which do not get referred to the editor-in-chief.
Of course there are.
Not everything gets referred to the editor-in-chief. Now, the key is it referred sufficiently far up the chain of command? And in this case, I think the right referrals were made.
But I need...
Of course, it's important to give Ken McQuarrie the chance to find out exactly what happened.
But you must have known what happened because a tweet was put out 24 hours beforehand, telling the world, 12 hours beforehand, telling the world that something was going to happen on Newsnight that night that would reveal extraordinary things about child abuse and that would involve a senior Tory figure from the Thatcher years. You didn't see that tweet?
I didn't see that tweet, John. I now understand.
Why not?
I check Twitter sometimes at the end of
you
the day, or
staff.
I don't check
you have
Twitter
an
at
enormous
all.
Staff of people who are reporting into you on all sorts of things. They didn't see this tweet that was going to set the world on
John,
fire.
John, this tweet, I'm afraid, was not brought to my attention. So I found out about this film after it had gone out. Now,
clear about this? Nobody said to you at any time, or to anybody on your staff who would then report to you at any time, look, we've got this Newsnight film going out. Newsnight should already light a few bulbs with you, surely. But we've got this film going out on Newsnight that is going to make massively serious allegations about a senior political, former senior political. Nobody even mentioned, in the context that we now understand, nobody even mentioned it.
No.
Isn't that extraordinary?
Well, in the light of what's happened here, I wish this had been referred to me, but it wasn't. And I run the BBC on the basis that the right people are put in the right positions to make the right decisions. Now, in this case, the film was not signed off in Newsnight. Legal advice was involved. It was referred to the right places in news management, and further referral upwards was made. So, in short, a serious consideration was given to this. But that, in my view, makes it all the more important that Ken McQuarrie gets to the bottom and finds out what's happened here.
When did you find out?
I found out about the film the following day.
The following day? You didn't see it that night when it was broadcast?
No, I was out.
So you heard about it the following day, and then what did you do?
I made inquiries as to find out why what had happened on Twitter had happened, because it seemed to me to be that the events of surrounding the film in terms of what happened on Twitter were an important part in understanding how this thing had achieved a scale and created a noise around potential identification that was clearly surprising. I mean, it's important to say. I don't think it's no kind of excuse or exoneration in this case, but it is important to say that the film itself did not make a named allegation.
But we know exactly what the background to that is now. But admittedly, you have seen the film now, I take it.
Yes, I have seen the film now.
And your view of it was that it was an abomination, journalistically?
Well, my view of it is that if Mr. Mesham has, Mr. Mesham rather, has made a mistake in his identification, then the film cannot
stand. There's no question if he says so.
No, as he has, there's no. If you had known that prior to transmission of the film could not stand.
Does it not surprise you that nobody actually showed Mr. Mesham a picture of Lord McAlpine and said, was this the man?
Well, John, I think there are a number of...
Well, does that surprise you? Let's put aside all the other things. Well, that is so fundamental that it's hard to
exaggerate. Can I just cover a number of journalistic questions I have, which I hope Ken Macquarie will answer for me? Did the journalists carry out basic checks? Did they show Mr. Mesham the picture? Did they put allegations to the individual? Did they think of putting allegations to the individual? If they did not, why not? And did they have any corroboration of any kind? These are the things we need to understand, because this film, as I say, had a legal referral, was referred up through the chain, yet it went ahead. There's some complexity here I absolutely need to get to the bottom of.
Precisely when did you learn that Mr. Mesham was, in this case, in this specific case, an unreliable witness?
Well, I think that's a harsh thing to say about Mr. Mesham. I think Mr.
Well, he's already told us he made a mistake.
I think Mr. Mesham...
He's apologised profoundly.
In the course of the film, Mr. Mesham tells a number of stories, gives a number of accounts of abuse in the North Wales care home system.
Rephrase it if you like. In this particular case, it's important, unreliable witness, because he said he got it wrong.
I became aware that Mr. Mesham had got this wrong yesterday, when he made his statement.
When did you learn that there were doubts about the testimony, about his testimony?
I only found out yesterday, when I saw him make his apology to Lord McAlpine, that there must be doubts about his testimony.
And you didn't ask any questions during the course of the week, because questions began to be raised very early on in the week, as you know.
No, John, I didn't.
Do you not think that you should have?
The number of things that there are going on in the BBC mean that when something is referred to me and brought to my attention, I engage with it.
So you have no natural curiosity. You wait for somebody to come along to you and say, excuse me, Director General, but this is happening and you may be interested. You don't look for yourself. You don't do what everybody else in the country does, read newspapers, listen to everything that's going on and say, what's happening here?
The second this was brought to my attention last night, I immediately
started... Brought to your attention? Do you not read papers? Do you not look? Do you not listen to the output?
I saw this break on the web, John. That's where I saw this.
Well,
it wasn't
indeed.
A question of it being in the papers, but the second I saw it, I started to make the inquiries.
Did you see The Guardian yesterday morning? Did you read The Guardian's front page yesterday morning?
No, John, I was giving a speech yesterday morning early on.
Aren't
some
things rather more important than others? I mean, do you not have to have a different set of priorities?
But you have to prepare for speeches you have to make, John.
The Guardian yesterday carried a front page story, which we now know was right, that cast doubt, serious doubt, on the BBC's Newsnight programme, a flagship news programme for the BBC. You didn't know that that actually happened?
No, I'm afraid I didn't.
When people ask questions about, and this is perhaps where we should get to your own future, when people ask questions about the role of the BBC, the Director General of the BBC, they point out, as Mr. Whittingdale just did, that he is the editor-in-chief. How do you define the responsibility of the editor-in-chief?
The editor-in-chief has to take complete responsibility for the BBC's journalistic output, but that does not mean that the editor-in-chief sits and signs off every single piece of it. The organisation is too big. There is too much journalism going on. The way the system works is that things brought to the attention of the editor-in-chief are effectively handed over to him. Responsibility is given to him at that moment. If the system is not referring things it should refer to the editor-in-chief, then it's not working properly. This is one of the things I need to look at.
We now know that it didn't work properly, don't we? We now know that Newsnight has failed massively on one programme, and it has failed massively on another programme, and it's caused the BBC enormous damage. You, as you say, as editor-in-chief, are ultimately responsible. Therefore, it leads to the obvious question... You should go, shouldn't you?
No, John, I've been appointed the Director General. The Director General isn't appointed only if things are going to go well. The Director General is appointed to deal with things which go well and things which go badly. Now, Newsnight has had two serious blows, and I have reacted in both cases.
No, the BBC has had two serious blows.
I understand the BBC has, but the two serious blows in this case refer to the programme of Newsnight, and in both cases, I've taken the action, the right action, to understand what happened and to start to be able to learn the lessons we need to learn.
But you did it too late. massively too late.
It's very important, John, to recognise that this is about Newsnight. Of course, that has huge implications for BBC, for trusting the BBC. I absolutely accept that, but it would be absolutely wrong to slur by extension the rest of the amazing work that's going on across the rest of BBC News. The reporting from America, from China, the fine work this programme does. 99% of what the BBC does is going out to the usual excellent standards and to the enormous satisfaction of its audience. I don't say any of that because I'm in any sense complacent, but I've got to understand what seems to have been going wrong on Newsnight. In the latest case, there's no question about it. That film shouldn't have gone out.
It's
absolutely unacceptable.
Did you want to stop that programme last night? The apology programme last night?
No, I thought it was absolutely vital. That
did you ever think about stopping Newsnight last night?
I thought it was absolutely... I've thought about a number of things, John, but I've decided I'm going to wait to see what Ken Macquarie reports before I make my mind up. The key thing for me last night was that Newsnight was given the chance to apologise. They made a mistake. It was really important that apology was put out in their programme.
You've already said that Newsnight will carry out no more investigations for the time being.
What I've said is that all investigative projects on Newsnight need to be halted while we check
exactly
the editorial rigour and supervision.
Have you given any thought at all to shutting down Newsnight?
No, I haven't, John. Newsnight is a 32-year-old programme with an incredibly proud record of excellent, award-winning journalism. One mistake has been made for certain here. We need to allow the Pollard Review to determine what happened at this time last year. I think it would be absolutely disproportionate at this stage to talk about closing Newsnight down.
How can you have a news programme that is not allowed to do investigative journalism, whatever investigative journalism, however you define it?
I'm taking the simple, prudent step there of ensuring that the quality of investigative journalism going on Newsnight is up to scratch. That is not the same as saying it can't do it. I need to look, I need to check everything it's got underway, and we need to make sure no more mistakes of the character of last Friday's are going to be made. That's vital. But I am not saying that Newsnight can't investigate in future. It's had a fantastic investigative record. I hope it will go on to do amazing investigations again.
The BBC has, hardly need to tell you this, a unique position in this country. It has unique privileges. And it earns those on the basis of the trust that the people of this country have in the BBC. That trust has been severely damaged, possibly destroyed, hasn't it?
Well, I don't believe it's been destroyed. The BBC has had crises of trust before. This is a bad crisis of trust, I admit it. But what you have to do is show your audiences that their trust in you is ready to restore. And the way you do that is you're open and clear about finding out what's gone wrong. And we've done that. We're doing that through Savile. We have two reviews, independent reviews, to find out what went wrong there in both cases and to be able to put those facts in front of the audience and show them the lessons we've learned from it. I'm doing the same thing here. This is a more contained case. I'm acting decisively and quickly this weekend. I hope to have a report on my desk by Sunday, by which point I hope, know exactly what happened, and I'll know what further action to take, including disciplinary action, if that's appropriate.
Disciplining other people, but at no point will you say to yourself, I, George Entwhistle, should have been much more alert to the dangers in all this. I should have been watching it like a hawk right from the very beginning. Everything Newsnight did in this area, I should have been on top of. Not editing the programme down there on the stone, as it were, but the Director General, the Editor-in-Chief, should have been on top of everything that programme did. I was remiss in that. It's no good me blaming other people because I am the boss. Do you not see that people will say, he's talking about disciplining other people, he's not saying, I was remiss.
John, you're effectively asking me to become the editor of Newsnight. I'm not. I'm absolutely not doing that.
He answers to you. You, therefore, should have said to him, what are you up to, old boy?
I was editor of Newsnight. I know what level of attention to detail that takes.
And you answer to your bosses.
That is where that level of scrutiny should take place.
Not with you at all. You're entirely blameless.
And I answer to my bosses. I answer to the trust. I am a director.
So not unless the trust says to you, Mr. Entwistle, we're worried about the way you've been running the BBC in this regard, this vitally important regard over the past few weeks. Not unless they do that will you consider your own position. Is that right?
John, I am a director general who has encountered these problems and is doing everything. I'm doing everything I can. I believe I'm doing the right things. I know that, there are times when I was thought to be a bit slow over Savile. I could have been a bit quicker to move to announcing the independent inquiries by a few days. I've admitted that. But the truth is, I'm doing the right things to try and put this stuff straight. That I am accountable to the trust in that endeavour. If they do not feel I am doing the right things, then obviously I will be bound by their judgment.
George Entwistle, thank you very much.